Macmillan Audio presents The Midnight Witch by Paula Brackston. Read for you by Marisa Calin. Chapter 1. London, 1913. The dead are seldom silent. They have their stories to tell and their gift of foresight to share. All that is required for them to be heard is that someone be willing to listen. I have been listening to the dead all my life, and they never clamour more loudly for my attention than at a funeral. This is in part due to proximity, of course. Here I stand, beside an open grave, sombre in black, quiet, watching, waiting, pain constricting my chest more tightly than the stays of my corset, and all around me souls stir. But they must wait. Wait to be called. Now is not the time. I know they are eager to speak to me, and I value their trust in me, but wait they must. It is always important what the dead have to say. At least they consider it so. As if departing this world has conferred upon their every single utterance a dignity, a value, that was not present while they trod the ground, instead of sleeping beneath it. There are times when their insistence and their self-importance tire me, I admit. Times, such as now, when I am far too consumed by grief to want to hear them. Even so, I can never forget, must never forget, that sometimes their words are indeed of great value. Necromancers through the ages have known this. We have learned to listen to their bold prophecies and their whispered warnings. What would the genteel lords and ladies assembled here today think, I wonder, if they knew that among them now are those who summon spirits from the past to divine the future? What would they think of me if I were to tell them that I am most at ease in a catacomb, or sitting in a graveyard cloaked in darkness, talking softly with those who have crossed the Rubicon and dwell in the land of night? That I find comfort and solace in the companionship of the dead, as my ancestors did before me. What would they say if I told them I have always harbored a secret fondness for coffins? There is something about their sleek lines, the rich tones of the bird walnut, the gleam of the brass fittings, the comforting thought of a place of rest and safety that appeals to me. Now, though, as I watch my father's coffin being lowered into its grave, no amount of admiration for its workmanship can distract me from the loneliness I feel. My father was not an openly affectionate man. Most thought him rather cold and aloof. But he loved me, and now he is gone. At 21, I should be excited about the future. Instead, I feel only the sadness of loss and the weight of duty upon my shoulders. My brother will inherit the role of Duke and all that goes with it, but I am heir to my father's other title, a position that bestowed upon him both immense power and fearsome responsibility. And now it is my turn. I am to become the new head witch of the Lazarus Coven. As I stand at the graveside, I let my gaze sweep over the gathered mourners. Hundreds have turned out to pay their last respects to the late Duke, but only a handful among us know that the coffin, which is the current focus of attention, and which is now being lowered into the damp, dark earth, is, in point of fact, empty. The August sunshine has warmed the soil so that its musky scent drifts up from the open grave. To me, the aroma is familiar and stirring. It smells of long ago, of ages past, of loved ones moved from this world to the next, of death and rebirth, of rot and regeneration. As the smell fills my nostrils, I identify the presence of cleansing worms and busy beetles, and under it all, from nearby newly filled graves, the subtle beginnings of sweet decay. I am not the only one to detect the presence of disintegration. From the branches of a majestic cedar comes the agitated cawing of sharp-beaked rooks. The heat of the summer afternoon is starting to tell on many of the mourners. The pool of black the gathered company presents seems to ripple as women sway unsteadily in their heavy gowns, their restricting corsets robbing them of much of what little air there is. Here and there, fans are worked listlessly. The men fare no better beneath their top hats, and some pluck at their starched collars. The relentlessly high temperatures of this summer of 1913 are not conducive to comfort for anyone dressed for a society funeral. Even the gleaming black carriage horses, despite standing in the shade of an ancient yew tree, fidget, causing the blackened ostrich plumes on their bridles to shudder and flutter in the inappropriately cheerful sunshine. I feel my mother's grip on my arm tighten. Her gloved fingers dig into the black night crepe of my sleeve. She looks worryingly frail. "Mama," I whisper, as close to her ear as her elaborately veiled hat will allow. "Mama, are you quite well?" "Oh, Lilith, my dear, I do feel a little faint." The Dowager Duchess teeters alarmingly. "Freddy," I hiss at my brother, who stands only a few paces off, but wears an expression that places him in another world entirely. "Freddy, for heaven's sake, help Mama."
"What? Yes, yes, of course. Now then, Mama, steady as she goes."
He smiles weakly, slipping his arm around our mother's tiny waist.
"Not long now," he murmurs. "Soon be over," he adds, as much to himself as anyone else.
I take in the pale couple that comprise my family, and wonder if I am equal to the task of looking after them. They need me to be strong, to take father's place. But how can I? How can I? My mother's very existence has been defined by her husband for such a long time. She was a duchess for so many years, and now she must alter her view of herself, of her position, to become Lady Annabel. She finds this modern, fast-changing world confusing and illogical, and overhanging us all is the possibility of war. She is adrift, and I must be her safe haven. It is so typical of Mama that she insisted on such a grand and lengthy funeral. She has overseen every detail, from the number and variety of lilies to the breed of the carriage horses and the funeral livery of the footman. I understand that she is sure in her mind that she knows precisely what her beloved Robert would have wanted. She believes it is expected of her, as the Duke's widow, to carry out his wishes. However keenly she feels her grief, she will not let it show. However lost she knows herself to be, she will present a small point of stoic dignity at the center of the cortege. Only those closest to her will be aware of how much she is suffering. I know the truth of it. My mother is burying not simply an adored spouse, but the greater part of herself. Freddy and I will go into the world and have lives of our own. She will remain in privileged purgatory, from now until the moment of her own death. No longer duchess, no longer wife, no longer with a purpose of place around which she can shape her existence. And Freddy. Freddy has singular problems which require singular remedies. Perhaps he can be persuaded to move out to our country estate in Radnorshire, far away from the destructive temptations on offer in the city. It would be a solution of sorts. But how will I succeed where even father failed? Freddy knows what he would be giving up if he went back to Radnor Hall. I fear he would as soon jump into father's grave.
That brother of yours will bring you to ruin.
Who is that? Who speaks to me unbidden, uncalled, unsummoned? What spirit would venture to do such a thing? Who is there?
One who watches you, daughter of the night. One who knows you and your worthless brother better than you know yourselves.
I must close my mind to this unwelcome, unfamiliar voice. Despite the relentless heat of the day, I feel a sudden chill. Spirits may become restless, may long to communicate,
but still they wait to be called. I will not listen. Not now. Now it is the living who need me. Freddy, perhaps, most of all. Watching him as he attempts to support Mama, he appears almost as insubstantial as she does. His skin has about it a transparency that seems to reveal the vulnerability underneath. Tiny beads of sweat glisten on his brow. He leans heavily on his cane, as if he cannot bear his own weight, let alone that of anyone else. I remember the first time Father brought us here, Freddy and me. It was gone midnight, and the house was quiet. He came to the nursery and told Nanny to get us up and dressed. I could have been no more than 9 years old, so Freddy must have been 7. It was certainly strange to be roused from our beds in the dark hours and to leave in the carriage with only our father. I recall Nanny's anxious face watching at the window as we left. Did she know, I wonder? Did she know about father? Did she know where he was taking us? He had the driver park the carriage at the gate to the cemetery, and then led us through the narrow paths between the graves. He walked quickly, and Freddy and I had to trot and scamper to keep up. I remember feeling a little excited at such a mysterious outing, but I was not afraid. My poor baby brother, however, was so dreadfully scared. By the time we reached our destination, this very spot, he was crying quite loudly, so that Father had to scold him and insist that he be quiet. We stood still then, among the tombs and statuary, letting the dark settle about us. I heard an owl screech, and several bats flitted past, their wing beats causing the warm summer air to stir against my face. Father said nothing, gave us no instructions, told us not a thing about what was expected of us. He merely had us stand silently among the dead, wrapped in the night. Freddy fidgeted the whole time, stifling his sobs as best he could. But I was quite content. I felt at home. I take Mama's arm once more and hold on firmly. The vicar presses slowly on with the service, his voice flat and monotonous, like a distant bell, weathered and cracked, echoing the dying heartbeats of the man whose body we commit to the earth, and whose soul we commend to God. Except that his body is absent, and his soul will linger a while yet. Beside a mournful statue of an angel, sheltering in the relative coolness of its winged shadow, and at some remove from the main company attending the Duke's funeral, Nicholas Strickland, permanent private secretary to the Minister of Foreign Affairs, waits and watches. He has no desire to engage in small talk with others in attendance, nor does he wish to give his condolences to the chief mourners. He wants merely to observe, to witness the interment, to assure himself that the leader of the Lazarus Coven is indeed dead and gone, once and for all, no longer occupying that privileged position of power and influence. A squirrel scampers by close to where Strickland stands. The quick movement of its claws on the dust-dry ground scuffs up fallen pine needles, some of which land on the senior-ranking civil servant's spotless shoes. He regards the needles with distaste. Their presence offends him. He does not consider himself unrealistic in his expectations of life. He is aware that perfection, however sincerely strived for, is often unattainable. However, it is his habit to aim for nothing less, so that even when his attempts fall short, a high standard is maintained. What he finds irksome, almost beyond endurance, is the way in which the actions of others on occasion cause his cherished ideal to be compromised. Focusing on his shoes, he exhales firmly, directing his breath effortlessly, as if it were within everyone's capabilities, the distance to his feet, so that the pine needles are blown away on a zephyr, and his shoes regain their matchless shine. The squirrel, sensing danger, freezes. Its face registers first fear, and then pain.
as it drops to the ground. After one small gasp, it is stilled forever. The nearby rooks fall silent. Strickland returns his attention to the family of the recently deceased Duke. He met Lord Robert's widow several times when she was still the Duchess of Radnor. No doubt she would remember him, just as she would remember all her guests. She would naturally.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.